Dear colleagues, it is exactly 6 p.m. We will wait 5 additional minutes and then we will start with the first webinar. Can you hear me? You have to unmute yourself, okay? Is the voice okay? Okay, thank you. I ask you, the non-Hungarian participants, was it clear what I have sent about the course? If you wish to answer, please unmute yourself in the lowest row.
Everyone is supposed to be unmuted.
Unmuted, okay. Adina, was it clear? Okay, welcome. What is you? Yeah. What? Okay. Okay. Are you radiologist, endocrinologist, or other specialties? Fernando? Yekaterina? Yekaterina. Not hear us? Okay. Endocrinologist, okay. So I will talk as we would around 100 joined to this webinar, because there are 96 participants who have registered to the course, and the opportunity is to review the recorded and edited version of this webinar as all other webinars. So maybe we are so few because many others are in working place and they will to review this webinar later. No. We have 2 additional minutes to start. Thank you. Okay, I think we were polite enough, and I start with the first webinar. So, dear colleagues and friends, I am Tamás Solymosi, the originator of this course. It is my great honor to welcome you in the name of the faculty for the first and hopefully not the last Papillon course on thyroid ultrasound. It is a great pleasure to welcome the 96 participants from 24 countries and 4 continents who believed that they can increase their diagnostic skills by joining to this unique event. Hopefully, we can fulfill your expectations. I will share a content. Okay. So, this first webinar will discuss firstly the course arrangement and very shortly the second topic, the how to find the thyroid ultrasound. The details of the topics are enlisted in this table. The course is quite a complete one and an attendant have to be aware of the structure. This course is a web-based event, so some technical issues have to be also discussed. The course is based on some principles, which will be shortly presented in the next item. The main feature of the course is that the basis of the training is not or not primarily the ultrasound still images, but the voice-narrated videos recorded at the time of the original examination. The use of video can be of serious importance in other respects as well. That's what I'm going to talk about. The last theme will be a professional one. This may be of interest to those who have no experience with ultrasound. In order to be able to use the course professionally, they need to be able to orient themselves in an ultrasound image. Before discussing the above listed themes, I shortly introduce the members of the faculty who are responsible for the scientific and professional standards. Cosimo Durante is the first in alphabetical order. He is an associate professor of internal medicine at the University of Rome Sapienza, Italy. He received his MD and residency PhD training in endocrinology at the University of Rome Sapienza. He trained at the Department of Nuclear Medicine and Endocrine Oncology in the Gustave Roussy Institute, France. Dr. Durante's clinical and research interests are focused on thyroid tumors management, including both benign and malignant neoplasms. He has demonstrated record of successful and productive research projects to more personalized thyroid nodule and thyroid cancer follow-up strategies. On this horizon, there is his contribution to the preparation of the European and American guidelines on the management of benign and malignant thyroid tumors. Professor Endre Nagy is the second member of the faculty. He received his medical degree from University of Debrecen, Hungary. After the endocrine fellowship training in Debrecen, he joined the endocrine research team in Walter Reed Medical Center, Washington, D.C. He has served as member of the Educational Committee of European Thyroid Association and the Surgical Task Force of the American Thyroid Association. Currently, he is chief of the Division of Endocrinology at the Department of Medicine, Faculty of Medicine, University of Debrecen, Hungary. His research focuses on the pathogenesis of autoimmune thyroid diseases, Graves' orbitopathy, iodine deficiency, thyroid nodules and cancer, and the utilization of new nuclear imaging techniques in endocrinology. He has published more than 100 research papers and is one of the authors of the Krakow Declaration on Iodine. Professor Enrico Papini is the scientific director of the Regina Apostolorum Hospital in Albano, Rome, and consultant endocrinologist in the same institution. He is lecturer of endocrinology and the postgraduate medical school of the Catholic University of Rome. He is the past president of the Italian AAC chapter and past president of the Italian Association of Clinical Endocrinologists. He is the Italian representative at the European Board of Endocrinology and fellow of the American College of Endocrinology. His scientific contributions covers more than 100 original manuscripts, textbooks, chapters, and Italian and international guidelines fall mainly in the following areas: ultrasound assessment of thyroid gland and minimally invasive treatments for thyroid lesions and endocrine tumors. Gilles Roux is the next of the faculty members. He is practitioner attached to the thyroid and endocrine tumors unit of Professor Laurence Lenhardt at La Pitié-Salpêtrière Hospital France, Paris. Activity oriented towards thyroid interventional radiology, such as fine needle aspiration cytology, core needle biopsies, charcoal tattooing, percutaneous ethanol injection, and thermal ablation and teaching of residents and fellows. He has been a lecturer in NEC module of the University Diploma of Ultrasound since 14 years. He is the author of more than 50 publications. And he was the first author of the Thyroids of the European Thyroid Association. Finally, me, Tamás Solymosi, I'm internist, clinical cytologist, expert of ultrasound of endocrine organs. I received my PhD degree in 2004 in the theme of clinical and morphological methods to improve the diagnostic accuracy of thyroid nodular goiter. I'm affiliate professor of the Department of Medicine at the University of Debrecen. I have published around 25 scientific papers. I have managed more than 150,000 thyroid patients, performed more than 125,000 thyroid and neck ultrasound examinations, and more than 50,000 thyroid aspiration cytologies, both aspirations and microscopic analyses. My main interest is in the postgraduate training in thyroid ultrasound and cytology. Can you hear me? A short answer, please. Okay. So let's turn to the first theme. I beg your pardon, the first theme is the course arrangement. The course has two parts, the online and the two-day in-person training. The online section attaches 33 GRAP-A attendants who have applied to this online training. The online course attaches all 96 participants. This online part is consisted essentially of two elements. The core material is the main learning material and is presented in the thyrocyte.com. Handling this requires individual and independent learning from the attendants. As you will see, we gave some clues to help the learners. The second element, the interactive part, is composed of two types of live webinars and the case of the month item. There will be 8 events, 8 webinar, type 1 webinar events. On these occasions, we mainly discuss ultrasound characteristics by analyzing ultrasound videos. 10 type 2 webinars will take place during the course. In these live events, 19 renowned experts present 30-minute lectures followed by 15-minute discussion. The case of the month item speaks for itself. During the 8 months, 8 such events will take place. 2 or 3 cases will be presented and the questionnaire has to be answered. So let's see these parts in detail. Okay, you see this web page, the Papillon course on thyroid ultrasound. Did you see this? Okay, it means that I have successfully. It is the greatest. I can enlarge a bit more. Okay. So the course, the core material, is composed of 7 sections plus supplement. Each section is consisted of several chapters, with a total of 40 chapters. We present thyroid ultrasound and related topics. Let's see one chapter, the most voluminous one, the section 2, nodular goiter. It is composed of 9 chapters, this section, and let's see one of these chapters, for example, the nodule borders section. You can see here 7 items. This is a short introduction to the lecture. I briefly discuss the various elements what you can find here. 2 types of items, the introduction and the manual, serves as a guide to the participants through the team. It is worth starting a team with this introductory lecture. Okay, we can hear some about this pre-recorded video. The second, the manual, discusses also a similar way as introductory video, but it focuses mainly on theoretical issues. In the introductory video, I present numerous images, while in the manual, I give an overview about the topic similarly to a textbook. The next element is the so-called courses. In this case, you can find 8 comparative tables. These comparative tables serve to present the ultrasound characteristics, the pitfalls, and differential diagnostics. You have the opportunity to view this in normal view or in enlargement. In the first topic is the non-pathological causes of blur. Here you can see numerous ultrasound images with captions. I try to explain what to see here. You can follow with the next item and so on. So this course is based on still images. I think that the essence of the course is the next, the case study section. In the event of nodule borders, more than 60 case studies are presented. Let's see one of them. For example, this one. This is the index page of a case study. Here you can find the details of the clinical presentation, functional state, the palpation finding. I summarized the ultrasound findings, gave the cytological diagnosis, and if the patient was operated on, I present here the final histopathological diagnosis. If it is necessary, I gave some comments about the case. It is worth starting with the first index case. Then you can see the right lobe of this patient on transverse scan. Here you can see some legends. After finishing the series of ultrasound images, you can reach the voice-over video. We will hear some about this. Okay, this is enough for this time. Naturally, you can navigate also back. Around 30% of cases and more than 80% of thyroid cancers, I present even the cytological images. Naturally, this is not part of the Papillon course. Nevertheless, it can cause no harm if you delve yourself into details of cytology to become familiar what are the cytological issues in such cases. You can go here back to the case and then navigate to the next case study or back to the previous one. Most of the chapters contains a video library. The video library presents exclusively the ultrasound videos. So start with the first one. It is very similar to the case studies, except for that we did not give the ultrasound details in text. So you have the experience as you would examine this patient by yourself. Here are the clinical data, the palpation finding, and the laboratory data which were available at the time of ultrasound. Then you can start with the video, which is in this case not voice narrated. You can form your own opinion by viewing the video, and after reviewing the video or enlarging or any other manner, you can form your own opinion, and thereafter you can click here and go to the case study in which the expert opinion can be also read. And naturally here you can see the same video with voice narration. After you checked your opinion, you can go back and go to the next case study in this video library. This chapter contains an exam item. I will speak about this later. So this is the essence of the core material, seven sections, 40 chapters, and one chapter is consisted of these elements. The other type of online material are the webinars and the case of the month items. We present two types of webinars. The first, the type 1 webinar, focuses on ultrasound characteristics, and these webinars will be presented by myself. Essentially, we try to commonly discuss various ultrasound features. The second type of webinars are presented by renowned experts of the subject. These are classic presentations, 30-minute live presentations, followed by 50-minute discussions. There will be 8 type 1 webinar and 19 lectures at 10 different occasions as type 2 webinars. Let's see the next type 1 webinar, which will be held on November 4th. In advance, I present 7 cases which will be discussed. It is worth to review these cases in advance. Here you can find the clinical data, then you can view the video. The video 1 and 2 belongs to the same case, but in these events I give enlargement or slow motion or try to highlight what you can see. This is the first case which will be presented on November the 4th. Then you can go to the next case, clinical presentation, the topic which is attached, and then you can find this video or view this video. So essentially in this first webinar or second type of webinar, there will be 7 case studies. It is worth to delve into the details in order to use more efficiently these webinars. So this first webinar will discuss the nodule composition and echogenicity, and it is worth to overview of the relevant sections. One more important thing, this is the summary. 4 days after the event, I will present here in the summary the recorded and edited version of the webinar. In all cases of the webinars, you can see this summary here till the end of the course, it means till May 2022. So this is a type 1 webinar. Type 2, let's see the first event. It will be present next Thursday. We will have two lectures, one held by Professor Nagy, the other by Eva Csajbók. These will be classic live presentations followed by 15 minutes discussions. These will be also recorded, and depending on the approval of the speaker, they will be presented in this homepage for several weeks or until the end of the course. So these were the two types of webinars. The third interactive event is the case of the month section. I think it speaks for itself. The course lasts for 8 months and we have 8 case of the month sections or items. The October 2021 is alive. We are welcome your response until 20 of October. Here we present 3 different cases. Click on the first. Here you can see the description of the case, clinical presentation, palpation finding, functional state. We highlighted which is the lesion in question. Then you can view the video, record, and thereafter you have to answer this fill-out form. In this case, 6 questions have to be answered. Thereafter, you have to submit your answers. Then you can go to the next case, similar structure, the case fill-out form, and the third one. In this case, there will be presented, there are presented 3 different case studies. At the end of the month, it means on October the 31st, I will present here at the summary the distribution of answers with an expert commentary. So in this case, you will find 3 summaries at the end of the month. So this is the case of the month item. We gave some clue how to handle this huge material. In fact, it requires 100 to 300 hours of learning time. The materials which are presented, which are the backbones of the training, are enlisted under the materials button. We gave a syllabus, a proposed schedule how to learn, with the time required to handle one and other sections. There are sections which require only 1 or 2 hours, but there are more voluminous sections. For example, the intranodular hyperechogenic figures requires, it is a judgment, 10 hours learning time. So this is the syllabus. Naturally, you can learn on your own and you can find another way how to learn, but this is a proposed syllabus for the entire 8 months. The curriculum is another important document. Here we summarized the core on the web, which type of materials are presented. In the legends, you can see what this P, M, and D means in the core. And we have enlisted the 2 types of webinars with the date of this. So this curriculum gives an overview what you can meet on this course. So I think I'm over on this topic on the structure of the course. I ask you whether if anybody has any questions. It's clear. It was fully superfluous to talk about this course structure. No questions. Okay, if not, I will give this in the next topic. So I will talk about the exams. So let's see what is the next topic. Where is here is you? Yes. We discussed this. And now I will talk about the conditions which is required to complete the online part of the course. Basically, there are two conditions. First, you have to pass 6 exams. Second, to participate in 5 out of the 8 case of the month events. The participation means that you have to submit the answers to the questionnaire regardless of whether the answer was correct or wrong. Go back to the 6 exams. 4 of them are already available, and these are related to 4 chapters of modular goiter section. The 5th one will be presented by the end of the year and affects the relation between discrete lesions and true nodules. The 6th will be a complex exam, which will be presented by April 30, 2022. This 6th exam will also include questions related to the presentations in webinar 2. Let's see how it works. I will go back to the thyroside. So, the modular goiter section contains 9 chapters, and 4 of them has exams. The echogenicity, the intranodular hyperechogenic figures, the border section, and the thyroid sections. Let's see how it works. So, in the thyroid chapter of the second modular goiter section, there's an exam. First, you have to log in with your personal code, which was provided by the first letter. After you have to log in, you have to start with the exam. 20 case studies and 20 questions will be presented. Let's start with the 4th. You can see the clinical details. Thereafter, you can view the video. And thereafter, you have to answer the question. In this case, you have 4 opportunities, only 1 is correct. So, you can start with the video. If it is necessary, you can review once more and more times this video in order to give a correct answer. Okay, I stop this video. I don't know that the correct answer is the 1st. After you have to give the answer, then the next question will appear. I go quite fast through these 20 cases, random answers, in order to view what happens after you finished one exam. Okay. 2 more questions for this time. I think this is the 16th, 17th, 18th. No, it was the 30th. Oh, I did not pass the exam, unfortunately. Either you pass the exam or fail the exam, you have the opportunity to review the cases. Click on the control button. Here will appear the 1st of the 20 questions. Here is your answer. It was wrong. It is highlighted with red, while the correct answer is highlighted with gray. You have the opportunity to view this case with voice narration here, or go to the relevant case study. For example, I click here and in a new window appears the case which was answered. I close this window And I go to the next question. It was again a failed answer. Go to the third and try to find one. When I hit the answer, no, no hits, yes. If you hit the correct answer, then it appears highlighted with green. So if you fail an exam, you have unlimited numbers of occasions you can re-exam. So the goal is not other than to force or initiate to view much more videos, any more videos. So the goal is this. So you can start over and over. You have to reach at one time 75% of questions. If you pass an exam, I will get a notification that you have successfully passed this particular examination. I will get no notification if you failed an exam. So this is the first condition to fulfill the course. Once more, four exams are in modular goiter sections. These are also already available. The six will appear in this advanced course section in lesion and nodule. And the sixth one will be at the end of the course by April 30. The second condition to fulfill the criteria is to participate in 5 out of 8 case of the month items. Okay. I ask you again whether it was clear or requires some more explanations. Okay.
Okay.
So now we turn to the next topic. This attaches some technical issues. First, it is important that the arrangement of the thyrocyte, first of all, the case study shares scientific informations. I will present an example. It requires appropriate monitor and appropriate resolution. It is worth viewing the case studies and ultrasound videos in a relatively dark room. The second affects the videos. I will present how to use the YouTube. As I see, much of the colleagues are belong to the X or Y generation, but I think that similar to me, there are some A or B generation participants who may require some clarification. One of the most important considerations is here. We will have altogether 17 events, live events. It can be excluded that in all occasions the internet connections will be perfect, either for my connection or any of the participants' connections. I emphasize here again, you have the opportunity to review the webinars even when you could not participate in the event or if the internet connection disturbed the event. So you can find the recorded and edited version of the actual webinar. So let's see these technical problems in the homepage or technical issues. Again, we are on the website. Okay, you see the website? Okay, so it is the starting page. I advise to click here on the introduction. Here you can find a short technical help. So one problem is the arrangement of a case study. I present here one single example. Here you can see the index page. The arrangement itself shares important scientific information. The first row presents the first examination, the second visit, and the third one. You can compare the images. Here you can find an intact thyroid, then an acute phase of subacute Waegener's thyroiditis, and here you can see the healing process. This is seen in PCs or Macs or tablets with good resolution. Great proportion of mobile phones is not appropriate for this arrangement. I show you what you see on a mobile phone. The mobile phone makes a rearrangement because the resolution is not enough to appear five small images in one row, so you can see in an order the same images, but you have lost not very superfluous scientific information. So therefore it is best to see this case study item on PC, Mac, or good resolution tablets, and I know there are some mobile phones which can give these arrangements. So this is one consideration. The second technical consideration relies on videos. These videos are embedded in YouTube. When you start the video, you have some opportunities. The first one is that you have to check the quality. All videos, most if not all videos, were uploaded in high definition. If your internet connection is not the best, the YouTube will change the settings automatically to much worse resolutions. So if this HD does not appear, you have to make a change in the settings manually to this one. The second, by using the YouTube, you have at least two opportunities. First, this is the full screen mode, and the high definition recording allows to enjoy the video even in full screen mode. This is a very simple task. We go back. The second possibility, that you can change the playback speed. Not infrequently, it is much better to view these videos on a slower motion. If you change this, you can delve in more details. Naturally, in this event, also the sound will be elongated. So, I muted myself, and here you can see this in slow or slower motion. So this is the most important task, to check the resolution of the video, and if it is not at the HD level, you have to reset manually to the best resolution. Otherwise, you lose one of the most important advantages of this course. The videos can be enjoyed in the same quality as if you would stand next behind the patient and would perform the thyroid ultrasound by yourself. Okay. I asked you again whether it was clear or not. Clear. It was clear. Okay. So we go forward. The next item I give four principles or considerations on which this course is based on. The first is a very concerning professional issue. To interpret an ultrasound image is not a very simple task, and the most important concern relies on the lack of biological standard. In most, if not all, ultrasound characteristics, we have no biological standard. The pathologist will not find a microcalcification. He will not state that this lesion was really hypoechogenic or isoechogenic. The borders of the nodule are only exceptionally examined by a gross histopathological examination. So we are no biological standard. If we have no biological standard, we have to interpret what we see. A uniform interpretation would require clear, widely accepted, and as exact as possible definitions. When you manage this course, you will find that in most cases we lack such quality of definitions. It means that the interpretation of the author, in this case, the interpretation, my interpretation, is necessarily subjective and debatable. So you have to handle this with criticism. What you have seen, I try to give some clue to form your own opinion. But this is an objective limitation, not this course, but the objective limitation of the ultrasound examination itself. It is reflected by the very high inter-observer variability regarding the most important ultrasound features. The second consideration relies on the definition of thyroid nodule. In the 7 or 8 most important guidelines, only one tries to give a definition on the thyroid nodule. The American Thyroid Association states that the thyroid nodule is a discrete lesion which is radiologically, it means ultrasonographically, distinct from the surrounding thyroid tissue. If we take this definition seriously and literally, then all human beings would have thyroid nodule. So this probe to define a nodule, seemingly a simple task, I think it fails. I try to give another definition on which reflects the approach of the course. A nodule is a radiologically distinct lesion which corresponds to any of the 3 possible types or kinds of pathological nodules. The virtuality is the ultrasound examination, while the reality is what a pathological sees. So I think that we have to compare our findings to the reality, it is to pathology. And only 3 kinds of pathological nodules exist: the non-tumorous hyperplastic nodule, the benign follicular adenoma, and the various forms of thyroid cancers. So this is the definition of thyroid nodule which was used during this course. The third consideration relies on video. I will speak about this later. The fourth is the potential of thyroid ultrasound. If we read the guideline, we see that ultrasound is dedicated to 3 different purposes. First, to diagnose a nodule, then to select a nodule for fine needle aspiration cytology, and finally to guide fine needle aspiration cytology. So this is a simplified version of the algorithm. Suspicion of nodule, ultrasound defines whether a lesion exists and whether a lesion would be a nodule. Thereafter, we analyze various ultrasound features of the nodule and decide on the ultrasound pattern whether FNA is indicated or not. And finally, if we perform FNA, it is guided by ultrasound. But what comes after the phase of evaluation? In around 2/3 of cases, cytology is not required, or resulted in benign lesion. In 10% of cytologies, the FNA is not diagnostic, while in another 15 to 20% of cases, FNA results in Bethesda 3 or 4 lesion. This is a simple task. If the lesion proves to be cancer or suspicion of cancer, it has Bethesda 6 or 5 category, then not to deal with, we have to send this patient to surgery. But we have to realize that in more than 90% of cases, after the evaluation, we have to start thinking. In 2/3 of cases, the question is whether to operate a patient or not based on the presence or lack of compression signs. What decides whether the patient has really a compression sign? The size of the nodular lobe and the position of the thyroid, two features which will be determined by ultrasound. The ultrasound has an even more important role in the 25 or 30 patients of percent of patients where FNA was inconclusive. In this category or categories, the risk of malignancy is below 10%. We have to make a stratification because a 90% rate of unnecessary surgery would be unacceptable. How to make this stratification? We have to reconsider, re-evaluate the ultrasound features. So if someone has the impression that ultrasound is finished when we performed aspiration cytology, I think he fails. But many evaluation graphs did not use this potential of thyroid ultrasound, and this course, one of the main messages of this course, or main messages of this course, would be that we can use the thyroid ultrasound even after the phase of evaluation. So I turn to the fourth consideration, the role of video record. So if we perform a thyroid ultrasound examination for 90 or 300 seconds, it means that we saw more than 2000 images. If we try to teach someone by using still images, we selected 1 to 3 images out of these several thousands. So it is clear that ultrasound is clearly superior to still images. For example, a microcalcification or comet tail artifact issue or a microcalcification or back wall figure issue can be decided only by analyzing the live recording or the video. There are some other perspectives if we use videos. First, the learning, it was discussed. The ultrasound video has a very important role in quality control. I will present an example. The learning process can be much more effective. Imagine you are a beginner. You examine 10 patients in 2 hours. A tutor has no time to stand by yourself for these 2 hours, but if you recorded the videos, then you can select a 10-minute summary, those portions of the videos which caused issues or concerns to you. So much more effective for your time and for the time of the tutor. There is another possibility which are used in CT and MRI. This is a remote diagnosis and consultation. This is not used in thyroid ultrasound, but I think that this is a possibility. So, excuse me, I require 1 or 2 minutes because I will try to find the example which I try to present. Yes. Here we are. Okay. Do you feel the address? Sometimes one feels this is what you see. Okay. So this is a case study. This is a more than 15 years old story. I worked with a very excellent surgeon who was occasionally very mean and phoned me late in the night if my cytological diagnosis failed. In this case, I examined an almost 60-year-old hyperthyroid woman. I found multinodular goiter, including nodules which presented microcalcifications. I targeted three different lesions, and the cytological diagnosis resulted in three different types. The right lobe, okay, this is not a very good, it's an out of date image, but you can find here the carotid artery, here is the trachea, and here is the right lobe. There were several nodules in the right lobe. One of them was aspirated, and the cytology resulted in benign lesion. There was a hypoallergenic nodule with microcalcification in the isthmus. My cytological diagnosis was oxyphilic tumor, and here in the left lobe, there was also a hypoechogic nodule, again with a microcalcification, and my cytology resulted in suspicion of papillary cancer. So the surgeon called me at 23 hours late in the evening and was very warmly regarded my excellent abilities in thyroid cytology in this time, excellent, other time not. It was a great job. He really and warmly congratulated that this patient had three different diagnoses and I hit all three, one including a papillary microcancer. Okay, sometimes one feels that I is able to walk on water. At this time there were no electronic records database. I regularly checked my patients, the histopathological results. I visited the pathological unit a couple of months later, collected the histopathological diagnosis. And what I have found in this case, really, the patient had three different diagnoses. It's okay. It was a colloid goiter cytological diagnosis. It proved to be a benign hyperplastic nodule. In the isthmus, in which I diagnosed an oxyphilic tumor, the histopathology was also hyperplastic nodule. In the event of this relatively large nodule in the left lobe, in which I raised the suspicion of papillary cancer, the diagnosis was oxyphilic adenoma. But where was this papillary cancer? I will show it, but the first lesson of this study. I hit three diagnoses, but I missed two of them. If I did not compare my ultrasound images and ultrasound descriptions to the gross pathological finding, I would fail, and I believe that I hit all three diagnoses. So the first lesson that we have to compare our diagnosis to the gross pathological findings. The second lesson, I start here with the video. Start. No, it fails. Okay, then I did not, I cannot present this video, but I present an image gained from this video. This image was not recorded at the original examination, but I gained this image from the video. I knew that this papillary microcancer was in close proximity to the oxyphilic adenoma from the histopathological description. But it was here. So if I did not record my ultrasound video, I would not find this small 4 mm papillary microcancer. So my message that you have to record your videos, this is the only way to correct quality control, and you can learn much, much more from your failures than from other things. Naturally, our masters are very important. Our patients, who were our victims in cases in which our diagnosis have failed, is also necessary. But in this exact, in this actual team, the ultrasound video, the recording of the ultrasound video is the most important one. So, this was this ACE study. Any questions? I did not hear you, Cynthia. If you talk to ourselves, please unmute yourself, Cynthia. No, I tried to unmute her, but I'm not able to unmute. I sent her a message. Oh, Cynthia. He left the course. Okay, other questions? Please? Camera is on. Okay, if your voice fails, you can send a chat message with your question. We are not very much, we are 16 in this webinar out of the more almost 100 participants. So you can ask anyone. It is a familiar mood. Now, Cynthia, can you hear me? Yes? Okay. You can send the message in chat. Okay. We can wait, we move forward, and if you have questions, you send a message to us. So I think I finished what I wanted to speak about this first topic. The second topic, I did not want to speak too much about this content. This is the most important one. You find here in section 1 introduction, this execution video. This is a 18 minute long video, and it is important, absolutely important for a beginner to find the thyroid ultrasound and to orientate by herself or himself. I do not want to present this video because everybody can view this in the internet, and it is not required to view this video for those colleagues who can perform a thyroid ultrasound examination, but for those who are beginners, it is essential. I gave some clues in this video how to make some steps forward toward your own education. Naturally, an online course is not able to teach the practice of thyroid ultrasound, how to manage this in the everyday practice, but I gave some clues how to make it. The first task is to make a horizontal scan. It is much easier than to make a longitudinal scan. I presented how to find the esophagus, how to discriminate between the muscle fibers and other hypercholesterolemic structures. So it is the most important one. If someone cannot orientate him or herself in the ultrasound, then much of the course is superfluous. I think we have proved by beginners, a beginner views this video two times and he or she will be able to find the thyroid ultrasound, and he or she will be able to orientate him or herself on thyroid ultrasound. So that's the topics for now. And I really ask you if you had any questions. Maybe you are tired after a working day, but even if you have any questions not related to these topics, any questions about the course or any other, you can make it. We are 16. And this is quite a familiar mood, so if you have questions, please answer. Well, I guess you had not dinner and you wish to eat something. Okay. If not, I close this first webinar. And I raise your attention that if you have any problems, you can send me an email. I'm able to answer 20 emails, 20 plus emails a day for this 8 months course. So if I will be full with emails, I will speak to you. But you can see, it is very important for us to get comments from you. Not the good comments, we can learn from the bad comments. If you have any problem with the structure, with some of the case studies, we are welcome. You are welcomed to any comments. If not in this open discussion, you can send an email. My last question is the same. Any questions? Okay. Then goodbye, good evening. We will meet next Thursday at 16 hours when Professor Nagy and Eva Csajbók will present the first Type 2 webinar. And you will find the edited version of this webinar on Sunday evening on the thyrocyte.com. Bye bye, everybody.
6 p.m. next Thursday.
Bandi, maradunk még? Vagy telefon?
Inkább mindjárt el fogok
beszélni. Jó, oké, akkor elköszönök én is, oké.
Egy 5 perc, ma felhívom.
Jó, oké, 5 perc, jó, oké. Oké.
Fölteszem, és bárki meg tudja nézni.